Wake up, Tucson. It's your town. Get up and get involved. It's Wake Up Tucson with Chris DeSimone on AM 1030, KVOI, The Voice.
This town is a lonely town, not the only town like this town. This town is a make you town.
Eight oh seven in the morning. You're on the Wake Up Tucson show, and you hear the chairman of the board. Third hour. Make sure you join us tomorrow. Dan Shearer, Green Valley News. Jim Manley, lawyer for the Goldwater Institute. In the second hour, we'll talk about another couple of little triumphs over Chuck and his 18,000 lawyers at Pima County on a fried chicken deal. I was actually just talking chicken with our next guest, believe it or not, down in Rocky Point. Make sure you join us for the meatball battle, 3 p.m. Sunday, August 27th at Rincon Market. We'll have five restaurants making amazing meatballs vying for your vote. The winner gets a portion of the proceeds goes to their favorite charity.
Very good.
So it could be a nonprofit. It could be to support a local, you know, could be your kid's football team. It could be anything that does a little better in society in Tucson, Arizona with the money. So please join us 3 p.m. $15 gets you all your samplings plus a wine or beer included.
Deal.
It'll be a rocker. After we had like 75 to 80 for the sandwich battle. So we're thinking
we're going to push. Who won the sandwich battle?
Rocco's Little Chicago.
Oop.
And we sent a check of like $530 to Emerge Women's Center, which
very
used
nice.
To be the Brewster Center.
Right. Yep.
And then, remember, I'm on this, prestigious Transportation Advisory Board. And we're
got a new suit and everything. Look
oh,
at
sweet
yeah.
suit.
Yeah.
It's like one of those orange ones that the prisoners wear when they dig the when they take the trash off the medians. We're doing a bunch of open houses. Reggie Drought, who's the other appointee, who's much classier and neater than I am. 17th, which is this Thursday, is the first one. That is at the River and Craycroft Library. Meeting starts at 6 p.m. And then 24th at Nanini Library, 7th at Oral Valley Library, and the 9th at Bear Canyon Library. So I've been promising this for hours now. Mm-hmm. Good morning to David Morales.
Good morning.
How you doing, sir?
Excellent.
And we are going to solve race relations, Dave, in 60 minutes or less. Is it possible?
Probably not.
But we're going to try.
We can start.
So let's get to the elephant in the room, as we like to say. And David, if you're new to the show, just turned it on. Dave he teaches at Pima.
Mm-hmm.
He teaches math.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to geek out on calculus and cosines, he'll love to do that with you one day.
Definitely.
And at the same time, he does do we call it a blog?
Mm-hmm.
It's called 3sonorans.com. And, of course, one of our common threads that we like to talk about a lot is TUSD getting its act together.
Yeah.
So we have a kerfuffle going on nationally and locally.
Mm-hmm.
And we had – and let me say it one more time so I don't get in trouble. The neo-Nazi white supremacist jackasses in Charlottesville are pieces of trash. Let me get that out right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I'll say it four times if I have to. Now – so we had three people died, and one including a young lady who was counter-protesting the white supremacists who was run over by one of these jackass white supremacists.
Mm-hmm.
So in the wake of that, so I really do shut off my Facebook
mm-hmm.
on the weekends, my Christopher DeSimone one, because after a while, I just want to detach from this stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the bike watching CNN. And I saw this, and I said, I don't know what's coming out of the wake of this, but there's nothing good that can come out of the wake of this.
Mm-hmm.
So we had Trump said something that was not a total condemnation of the neo-Nazi guys. He did say he deplores bigotry and violence.
On all sides.
On all sides. Mm-hmm. And then McCluskey puts a Politico article. Captain, see, I call him Captain Chaos for a reason. You guys think he is chaos, okay? And Supervisor Miller put a quote on there. So what I want, really, I want you, the reason, now it worked out well because Tom Transdale actually rescheduled his, he had a family thing he had to take care of. So he rescheduled his 8 o'clock interview with me, and I said, well, maybe this is fortuitous that I can invite you on. You haven't started school yet either, so maybe we can do this discussion. So what I want you to do for me, educate the barbarian here, okay, on why, and this is what I put on Tim Steller's Facebook post yesterday, specifically, someone tell me why this is racist. I don't know if you think it's racist or not. So you were telling me a little bit out in the green room a little bit. Let me get your take on it first, on what she said, and then we'll go from there.
Well, first of all, I took a screenshot and I wrote about it on Three Sonorans, and it's a very short article, and I never call her racist in there. I never call for her resignation. I just said, you know, this is what she posted, and try to keep it light, and just gave like a one paragraph history of whiteness and what it, you know, the concept of the white race in this country, and that's a whole, you know, you can take graduate studies on whiteness and the creation of the white race and because it didn't exist before, you know, like you were in England for centuries, you're not going around saying you're white, you're just English, you know, to get right to the point, there was outrage going on all morning long that this was allowed to happen because, you know, I've been at MAS rallies here in town where people are just peacefully protesting on the corner and the cops say this is an illegal assembly and, you know, you can't be there. So cops have the power to shut stuff down,
right,
if they ever say public safety or whatever. And then there was already, you know, it was rioting, there was beatings, and you can see pepper spray and, you know, it was just going on and it was like a provocation. It was like, we're going to allow this to take place just to see what happens in some way, you know.
Now, which riot is this?
The white supremacy.
The Charlottesville. Charlottesville, okay.
Yeah. And so, you know, people are it's going to escalate and it's going to get bad. And I say, you know, police, like when there's G20 in town or you know, they have free speech zones. They separate the public from the bankers and so, you know, the elites. But in this case, they were allowing this to happen. You know, Black Lives Matter is there, and then you have the KKK, and it's like, this is not going to end well.
Right.
And of course, there was deaths, and, you know, the images were horrible. So there's a lot of anger. There's a lot of people are just upset. Deaths are occurring, race escalations, you know, tensions. And Ali Miller, who posted that afternoon, made it about herself. And she says, I'm tired of being hit because I'm white. And I mean, first of all, this isn't about you today. And then she says, I'm white and I'm proud. And I'm not, you know, no apologies. I'm doing it from my memory.
I can read it for you exactly. Yeah. I got it here. I'm sick and tired of being hit for being white. It's all about making us feel like we need to apologize. I'm white and proud of it. No apologies necessary.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing is just, it's insensitive. And she made it about herself right away. And it was not about her that day. It was about, you know, people died that day.
So she was responding to the Politico article that McCluskey put up, right? Mm-hmm. And the Politico article had to do with what?
I think what Trump said, right? His comments.
Right.
And, you know, even Trump's comments were, you know, there's... You know, you have to be a little bit classier today to be racist in some ways. You know, there are people who are still like the KKK who go out in the streets and are just, you know, straight up overt about it. But there's other ways to still undermine certain people in this country. There's still ways to, you know, code words that people use. And you know, Trump, you know, during the election when he was on CNN, you know, he said, I don't know who David Duke is. And, you know, the guy was like, you're not going to condemn the KKK. He's like, I have to learn more about them, you know. And obviously he knew who the KKK was because his dad used to go to the rallies. And David Duke, he worked with him in the...
So you think Donald Trump is basically a quiet racist?
I think he allows it to happen. He doesn't want to alienate that base. Now, it doesn't mean he agrees with them. It doesn't mean that he would be at the rally today. But he wants power. It's all about power. And so instead of condemning them right away.
Right.
I mean, even like the Nazi website yesterday was saying, look, this weekend, he never condemned us. You know, they were just saying it's code word. It's like.
So he condemned it 2 days later.
After a lot of pushback. I mean, what's so hard about condemning the KKK? And then even then he just says there's hate. What does that mean? I mean, you know, the KKK and neo-Nazis are on the streets. And here's the other thing. You know, like the Confederate flag and the Nazis, like these were our enemies during war, and they no longer exist anymore because the United States fought them. We fought the Confederacy. We fought Nazism. These are sworn enemies, just like ISIS is today. So, you know, if you know, the KKK, I can say, well, okay, you know, the First Amendment, you can get away with it maybe. But Confederacy and Nazism, just from, you know, sworn enemies of the United States, should not be allowed to try to reemerge in any way in this country. That's what I think. They're, you know, name them, call them domestic terrorists, because they are domestic terrorists. They have a
my
whole
thing
history.
Is, my thing is, all I was just having a discussion with a buddy of mine, and we're talking about this whole thing with Robert E. Lee, right, and the statue. Now, my thing is, the public just pulling down statues, there's still a violent aspect to this, mm-hmm. okay, that is not about peaceful assembly, and that I'm not a big fan of that. But then I said, I don't know why everyone's still so. My thing is, I don't understand why everyone's still hooked on the Confederacy in the first place. Let's forget about the idea right now that we're just going to say we're condemning the Confederacy. Who cares? That's my bad. The people who are still holding on to it, there's bigger fish to fry in this world, okay? Even Robert E. Lee, who was, and yes, was he one of the greatest generals of that century? Probably. Was he a really smart guy? Hell yes. But my thing is,
he was on the other side.
It was like, but he chose to fight for that in retrospect, maybe when he happened, he didn't think about it like that. Mm-hmm. But in retrospect, you were on the losing side of a war so you can own another human being, mm-hmm. right? Well, why is this something we're still saying this is super? You know what I mean? I don't understand the fascination with it anymore.
Well, the other thing is, okay, you know, maybe people aren't overtly racist, but then you have other actions like Doug Ducey saying, in the wake of all this, we're still not going to take down our Confederate state. They're not monuments, but state, whatever they are. You know, doubling down. And then, you know, then you have Trump condemning the KKK and neo-Nazis. And then just hours later, he's going to come to Phoenix next Tuesday to pardon our pile. So it's kind of like words and then his very actions. Because, you know, actions speak.
So we know this for a fact. He's coming to pardon our pile. Is this what they're saying?
That's what they're saying. He is coming to Phoenix next Tuesday.
So he's not. He's just not doing a speech. He's just coming quietly to see Joe Arpaio and do a little.
No, he's
moment
oh
to
no,
pardon
my,
him.
My bad. He has a arena that he already booked.
Okay, all right.
So he's going to do a rally. I'm sure at that rally he'll say, "And I'm going to, you know." And I mean, it's already out there. I'm not making this up. You know, ACLU's already responded. Other
well,
groups.
Well, thank God they responded. Now let's do this. We got to go pay some bills. Susie, we'll get to your phone call. 790-2040 is the phone number. We're going to get back. I still need help. You're gonna because I need with all our friends on Facebook. I need help in telling me what based on what she said, Allie. I want to get back to that a little bit. Mm-hmm. You're going to educate me on why this was really so bad. Not other than the fact that you said being insensitive on the day. Of the event, okay, the tragic event. So, Ed, let's spin us away, 790-2040, Wake Up Tucson. We're trying to do the peace playlist today for everyone here, so Wake Up Tucson.
Wake Up Tucson with Chris DeSimone on 1030 KBOI, The Voice.
8:24 in the morning. Ed Alexander, spinning the tune, 790-2040. We're going to start to at least trying to solve race relations in under 60 minutes. We don't know if we're going to make it. David Morales, Christy Simone. We'll get to your phone calls in just a second. So tell me, I need help with my buddies on Facebook.
We'll go back to Allie. Yeah.
Okay. So when I look at that statement again, other than the insensitivity of it being about her on that day, help me on the racism side. Because everyone's freaking out that, you know, on Facebook mostly. And the Arizona Daily Star rarely puts the same headline 2 days in a row. But this one's 2 days in a row. That's how much they hate Allie and how they're not really an independent news source. Literally, there's a story about all these people dying in mudslides someplace. And literally, it's right next to... Actually, it's bigger. The Allie Miller thing is bigger than at least 300 dead and 600 missing in Sierra Leone mudslides. I'm not making that up. I mean, it's the second day in a row of a Murphy Woodhouse piece that's like 200 words. It's not even that big. So I
think this will go national. I think it'll go make it to the New York Times because of the timing of it. It's just perfectly good or perfectly bad, whatever you want to call it. But there was a white supremacy rally, neo-Nazis and KKK, white supremacy. Right. And she declares her white pride hours after people were dying at this event. White pride is not something you shouldn't, you know, is it right or is it wrong? I don't know, but it's not cool for a politician to do that. And that's the issue is, and then the fact that she's the victim, I mean, who is really attacking her for being white? Who's saying, you know what, you're a white person, and so we're gonna enslave you or take away
your
property?
She was on James's show yesterday, and mm-hmm. she basically said, I didn't hear it. I'm just taking it from accounts of other people, mm-hmm. including yourself, that she basically was sick of identity politics, right?
But then she identified herself as a white person,
right?
I don't think she understood the contradiction that she was saying. She says, I'm so tired of identity politics. Then why did you identify yourself as a white person? You know, you played into it because when they ban MAS, whenever they go after Mexican Americans or even African Americans, it's always about you're an individual, not part of a group. And that's one of the parts of HB 2281. And in here, you're allowed to be white all of a sudden, but yet we're not allowed to be part of this race. You know, we're supposed to be Americans. We're not supposed to hyphenate our names and stuff. It was totally insensitive what she said. And where did it come from? Where was this anger? Because she should have been angry at the white supremacy, you know. And it just, you know, you put white supremacy and white pride next to each other on the same afternoon. That is why I think the story will go national next. And to me, you know, I said, like, now it's political. Now the Democrats want to go after whatever. To me, it's just,
Do you think Allie's a racist?
I don't know. I mean, this comment was not...
We have never seen anything out of her that's been close to racist up to this point.
You know, the question...
Could it have been bad timing on her part saying something that wasn't great in the first place? I'm not saying this is the smart thing to say.
So the thing is racism is interesting today because, like I said, people just don't go out there and say, you know, the N-word and stuff like that.
Right.
But consider that TUSD has been under a desegregation order for 40 years. By fact, kids... For at least two or three generations, are getting a less quality education.
Yep.
They're going to be disadvantaged.
Yes.
And it's okay. The reason it's okay is because if it wasn't okay, we would do something about it. You know.
So of course the whole problem with that, of course, mm-hmm. and what you're saying is true, mm-hmm. right? They aren't getting as good of an education as these kids. They are being disadvantaged by coming out of these TUSD schools. But again. For other than the last 5 months and 6 months when Judy Burns passed away and there was Stegman had a little three-person majority, it's been run by the Al Sharptons of the Latino community, which are Grijalvas.
Okay, so let's discuss.
Okay, that's the part on that. So you're right. So the idea that a guy named Raul Grijalva, who runs around the country as one of him and Luis Gutierrez, as two congresspeople who are the leaders of the Hispanic community in the United States of America, mm-hmm. okay, the idea that out of that 20 years of between him and his daughter, Hispanic kids have suffered in a school district that they've both served on the board. So tell me, please, why that's Whitey's fault.
Well, let's talk about a few things here, okay? So
I'll get the phone calls, I promise.
The whole problem is the system. The system itself is inherently like this. So, you know, can you really fix TUSD? I mean, you're going into the lowest socioeconomic part of town. I mean, there's poverty, there's kids going to school with hungry, and it's cause and effect.
Of course, the counter to that, the poverty is Flowing Wells. Why is Flowing, even though it's a smaller district, they probably have a worse economic demographic than TUSD as a whole.
I'm not just talking about TUSD, though. I'm talking about why is there parts of Tucson that are so economically disadvantaged compared to other parts, and how do you fix that inequality? Now, there's some things that you said that you probably never thought about, but like, Tucson Sentinel identified me as a Latino activist, and you mentioned, race is only attached to minority groups in this country. You're a Latino politician, you're a black activist.
I don't think I've ever referred to you as a Latino anything.
Well, but,
you and I are talking here. Mm-hmm. Whenever I introduce you, I always say you have a blog named Three Sonorans where you cover a lot of different things, including
TUSD. But you just referred to, Raul Grijalva as part of Latino, and you always group them together.
Does Raul Grijalva identify himself as a leading Hispanic leader?
No. But let me finish my point.
I'm using his words.
I know, but let me finish my point, sir.
Yes, sir.
So race identifiers can always be used for minority people. Now, one time you had Dan Gibson on the radio, and he mentioned that I once referred to him as the white editor of the Tucson Weekly. Now, why was that so awkward? Because white people never refer to themselves as white. They don't have to, because normal in this country is white. Normal is...
Is Dan Gibson the former white editor of the Tucson Weekly?
Yes.
Okay.
But see, there's nothing wrong with that, because you can say...
But you just said white's not a color.
No, the identification of that he is part of that, the white group. I don't know. I mean,
I'm just saying. You said originally there's white's not a color, but then we're talking about Dan, the former white editor of the Tucson Weekly.
Well, what I'm saying, there's the concept of the white race.
Dan's listening to this, crunching in his car, going, "Why are they talking
I mean, for example, think about what you just said right now with Raul Grijalva.
Yes, sir.
And say it in a different way. What are all the white politicians doing for the white community out there? Right? It sounds kind of weird, doesn't it? It sounds all, we don't talk that way.
Okay, let me counter that. Mm-hmm. And we got to go to break because we're running late on this one. Is which politicians, other than Allie Miller, refer to themselves as, "I'm the white congressman from North Dakota"? Okay? They don't refer to themselves in that context.
Mm-hmm.
But Luis Gutierrez and Raul Grijalva refer to themselves in that context all the time.
Yeah, because that's what our society imposes on us. So, of course...
They impose it on themselves. Okay?
You know what? It's they say, why do you have, gay pride or something like that? It's because you're that group that's being attacked by the dominant society. Okay? So sometimes you will say, okay, you know what? I'm attacked for being black. I'm going to have some black pride. I'm going to be proud of being black. I don't care. You guys are, vilifying me, attacking me.
So you can only have pride if you're in a perceived group that is being repressed by usually white people. I'm just saying.
We should just be people, right?
Of course.
And the response, the reason you say you're proud is because you're attacked.
Because that's what Eric Ryberg said, this guy on Facebook yesterday. He said, you can say, because I said yesterday, what if you replace the word white with Hispanic, right? What Allie said, I'm sick of being attacked because I'm Hispanic. I'm proud of being Hispanic. No apologies.
The difference is Hispanics are attacked, and white people are not attacked for being white in this country.
You can't say that unilaterally.
Yes, you can.
It's the same thing as what he's saying.
Are you saying that white people don't get attacked for being white? In the country, ever.
You can be white and proud, you can be black and proud, you can be brown and proud, you can be whatever and proud. Why can't you not be white and proud?
What are you proud of? What is white?
I'm proud of my heritage.
Okay, but you can say...
My parents who brought me up.
Yeah, I'm proud of being Italian, I'm proud of being Irish.
Well, that's why. There's nothing wrong with that.
Because whiteness was created to be non-black in this country. That's the history of white race.
That's your history.
No, there's history books. There's studies about this.
We've got to break you kids up. We've got to go pay bills. 8:34 in the morning. We'll be right back. David Morales, Chris DeSimone. I just found out he's a Latino activist. Wake up, Tucson. 10:30 twice.
Come on, the peace train.
Up Tucson, call us now, 790-2040.
Come on.
Beautiful. 8:39 in the morning. Christy Simone, D. A. Morales, and as I was telling David on the break, we have to finish this in a good healing way in the end. Not that we're, I mean, I like David a lot, and but so the question is, I was talking about just on the break, you know, that classic golden rule, right? Treat others as you'd like to be treated yourself. Mm-hmm. As a guy, I was, you know, I didn't even think about it until I got to Arizona. I was really privileged, not white privilege, to grow up where I did in New York, because I was in a school that I went to kids from everywhere. Everywhere. And we had every type of religion. I had friends that were Muslim, Taoist, Buddhist, Hindu. I mean, and so when I got to Arizona, it was a little boring. It was a little boring, you know? And so how do we get to a point, Dave, where we start treating each other as Americans again? You know, we're all Americans, all right? We're all human beings. How do we get back to, or how do, maybe not get back, maybe how do we get to that point where we stop using, we stop, I'm going to quote a little John Wayne here, we stop using the hyphen all the time of what we are as Americans.
Well, let's start. So if you're here undocumented and you've been here for 20 years and you have a family and a business, are you American?
That's an interesting question. So legally, no.
But see, when you talk about we're all American, we're not really, because there's some people who are second class or kind of almost American, or so.
So the question is, so we think there's 10 to 12 million people in the country that might be here illegally, right?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that is some of our own fault because we suck on immigration and different things like that. A lot of people overstaying visas and these types mm-hmm. of things, okay? So my take on that would be that, and my take on, first of all, they did come here not in the right way. All right? They did get here,
you know,
originally.
But if you're escaping drugs and a war, there is no right way. You know, your family comes first.
Before, I'm with you.
You know?
But I'm just saying, and they didn't really come here legally in the correct way. Let's just say.
Under the laws that were made by the current leadership.
That, and still the leadership. All right?
And that leadership is predominantly not like them, right? And so there's still that's what I mean by the system.
So Democrats like to talk about how the increase of captures of illegal immigrants by Barack Obama. Was mm-hmm. he white?
Half white.
He was half white.
He was. And he was brought up by his white family. But see, that's the thing. It's the system. Because so you can't say, well, Obama is black and he did this. So it's part of the whole capitalistic system where capital is, you know, treasured way before people are in this country. You know, where just treat the immigrants like there's slaves in this country today. You know, there's people in the fields that cannot escape the fields because they owe a debt to the people who brought them here. And this goes on, and this is the food we eat, you know.
But now, are their lives better in the U.S. than the one they left from Mexico or Honduras?
Usually not, because they're trapped. They cannot escape their...
So it was a mistake for them to come here in the first place.
It was. And none of them want to be here. They all want to be home, but they come here because they need the money.
Right.
And then now
they're
enslaved.
But that's just, that's life. You do need money to pay your bills.
Yeah.
And everyone deals with
that. And why is there disparity, you know?
So you would like to go to straight communism. Is that where you're at?
No. Not at all.
Because that's what you're saying. You want to eliminate the need for people to earn money to pay their bills.
Nope. That's not what I'm saying at all.
What are you saying?
I'm saying that, first of all, if we're realistic, so capitalism would say that there's no, the government should stay out of the way, the supply and demand, let it happen, right? Well, if we have a supply for workers and they're willing to work, it should happen. But the thing is, then race gets involved. It's like, well, these are not Americans. These are not, you know, they're...
Well, they're not.
Well, then we're not all... That's what I mean. You just started with saying, can we just all be American? But see, already we're split. We're not all just Americans. So this country...
So the question is, how many illegal immigrants on a regular basis of the 10 million, the 12 million... are every day protesting that they're being treated unfairly?
They can't. They'll be deported. You know, I mean, they can't even call when they get domestic violence at home because they'll be deported. So, but
I do want to clarify my stance on the 10 to 12 million. Mm-hmm. I am not of the classic hardcore righty that says deport them all. Mm-hmm. That's doesn't work. I do like a good path to citizenship for them, but they can't vote because that's the only. I'm going to tell you why.
No, that's fine.
That's the only way the Republicans would ever go for it, because the fear would be that they'll all become Democrats. So I'm talking about politically, they can do everything else, but they can't vote.
But
would
so,
you be okay with that?
But notice the position that you're speaking from.
Yes, sir.
You know, the position is, well, first of all, we're all Americans. Now it's, well, they're not really all Americans. So, you know, we're not going to find
well,
the
they
solution.
Well, they're not. They have to become Americans. They are Mexican nationals living
that.
In the U.S.
Yeah, I know. But what I'm saying is you're speaking from a position of power, like saying, I'll let them do this. I'll allow them to do this.
Right.
So there's no equality to begin with. Right, so that's the power structure that's in
being a Mexican national who came into a country illegally is not the equivalent of an American citizen
who's just born here.
That's the rules, buddy.
I know, but the thing is, you don't choose who you're born. You don't choose your mother. You don't choose where you're born.
It has nothing to do with that. It has to be legal or not legal.
So let me take this other. So now, so anchor babies, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the Mexican mom comes into America to have her kid. Right, mm-hmm. so she can get benefits from the United States taxpayers, right? This exists, yes?
I wouldn't say it like that.
What would you say?
People come here, and what were you saying?
So are there Mexican women coming to the U.S. to have children, so they get born, they have their U.S. birth certificate,
mm-hmm.
then going back to Mexico and collecting U.S. benefits, yes or no?
You tell me how many.
I'm saying I don't know how many there are. Well, I'm just saying is you just said
I'm talking about
circumstance of your birth is you can't control that. Well, sometimes mom does control where
they
you're born.
They try to, and they do. But the thing is that so like illegal is illegal. That's the system of laws in this country. So if you escaped from your slave owner, that was illegal, and then you were brought back.
So you're saying the people working the fields illegally, let's say in Fresno. Are pretty much the same as black slaves working on a plantation.
Yep.
Okay. Now, so we know we have 330 million people in this country. Can mm-hmm. we? Is that a good number for us
sure.
to work off of?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So let's max it out. We're gonna go 12 million. Now is the 12? No, the 12 million is not included in the 330. It would be an addition to that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that'd be 342. You're a math guy, but you know I can't do this all in my head, right? So it's 12 divided by 342 is 3% of the population. Okay, that's what you're talking about. I got it. 3.5. Let's be specific.
But not all of them are in the fields,
right? But we're talking about illegal immigrants, not just Mexican nationals. They could be from a variety of countries. So now let's just for now, because we only got one more segment, mm-hmm. right?
But notice the dehumanizing terms you're using. Instead of referring to them as humans, as a lot of them are Catholics, Jesus died for them.
Yes,
they're illegals. So they're already dehumanized. So you're saying at the beginning, you said, how are we going to?
I'm just viewing them as their citizen status, not
but
based
is,
on them
but
as
why
human
is that
beings.
Your perspective?
Why is because it that you always bring up the label?
Oh, stop.
You
so that's the discussion, though, we're having. We're having a discussion of citizenship status of these folks.
No, the discussion was originally, how do we all kind of get together racially? And I said,
let me make it feel better.
Americans.
These good human beings who are here illegally, pretty much of that number, make up 3.5% of the people living in this country. Do you agree with that number?
Yes, but what I'm also saying, that's your perspective to view them in that way. You can view them as these people who are hardworking, contributing members of society. You can view them as good Christians who take their kids to church and whatever. But you choose to view them as illegal.
So what I'm going to do for the next few months, I'm going to watch everything you write
mm-hmm.
and make sure that you are typing everything out about everyone else in this wholesome human way without using labels.
No, I'm not
it
saying
it goes both ways.
I'm not saying labels are bad. I'm saying the labels you choose to use determine a lot.
When we come back.
Why do you choose to view these human beings as they're just illegals?
When David and I come back, we're going to tackle the other 96.5%. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Let's do that. We'll never have time for a phone call, so don't waste your time. So we will be right back. Now, this is the most perfect song that you and I could have together. The We Are the World. Wake Up Tucson, 10:30 The Voice.
We are the one to make a brighter day, so let's not give in.
Talk about local issues. Somebody's got to do it. Wake Up Tucson. Mornings from 6 to 9 on AM 1030 KBOI. The Voice.
The children in the playground, the faces that I see. All races, all religions. That's America.
Too bad he's not listening to this.
To me.
He's not here to aware of it.
8:52 in the morning. You're on the Wake Up Tucson show. This is definitely a to-be-continued conversation with David, and I said to David, I said, thanks for having this conversation, because this conversation like this, the only person so far who's yelled a little bit, Ed's got a little excited, but having a calm conversation about this, we need to have more of these and not less of these, because I'm telling you, man, Facebook is so ugly. It's so ugly, and we were just talking about when McCluskey put the post up about the rainbow sidewalk, never said anything about LGBT anything. He just said, are we really paying $12,000 for a crosswalk? Mm-hmm. 700 to 800 comments and hate from everybody, both sides. I mean, it was like, guys, look at yourself.
I agree. I was criticized, too, just for asking, did the city actually pay for it? And, you know.
If there's a guy nowhere near homophobic, it's you. And they were going after you for being.
Yeah. So, you know, just a few things. I'm with Ali Miller. I actually, in my official endorsements, she was one of them.
Yeah.
I think she was on the JT Harris show about a week or two ago, and she was talking about the gay conversion therapy and then how they passed the $75 million thing under. I think there's good in what she does. And I think, you know, this is definitely not a. Like I said, even if you read my post, I'm not calling her racist. I'm just pointing out, like, these are the little things that we need to talk about.
Sure.
Is, you know, is it okay to say this or not? And maybe it is okay, but that's part of the conversation. And you know, I think the Democrats are going to skewer her on this. And but that's not my intention. My intention is just, let's, you know, what made her say that at that time? Why does she feel under attack as a white person?
So if you were sitting with her right now to tell her, to give her advice on how to, is it just come out and apologize and let's be over with it and move on? That's what you would tell her?
Well, you know, I think it would be interesting, and this is, you know, we're also talking about during the break, is that there's a whole field of study on this. And I think truly that a lot of people don't know this history of, like, how the creation of the white race came about. And so by discussing this stuff, so in a nutshell, basically, poor Europeans were being oppressed in this country, and instead of going after the elites who were oppressing them, who were keeping them down, they decided to, you know, they said basically, hey, you're white. Like, they created this.
What time period are you talking about here?
This is, it started about 400 years ago in Europe when the slave trade began, but in this country, it's been going on, and I can send you the documents that show, like, this is, they're like, look, you're white, and so you're more like the elite person than the poor black person down the street. And in fact, it's the reason you're poor is because of the poor black person. And
we can do this for like a whole show. So hold on. I want to get Doug in before we run out of time. Mm-hmm. If we run out of time, thank you for being here and thank you for having these conversations. Mm-hmm. Let's go to Doug Martin. He's on line one as always. Doug, what's up, buddy?
Hey, I appreciate, David, that you're coming on and talking about this. And I wanted to get back to something that you said about how people that are here that are undocumented are here because of fleeing bad situations where they're at. One of the things I'd like you to address is the cultures and the actual government and the corruption, but also the racism that exists in South America, particularly against indigenous people and black people. And I was talking to someone who's part of a migrant organization. She's the director of a migrant rights organization. She told me that indigenous people are treated terribly in Mexico, but blacks are treated worse. So what can be done to fix that problem? Because if people don't want to really be here, they'd rather be in their own country, then the problem is back where they came from.
So I'll just recommend one book that people can read. It's called The Open Veins of Latin America. It's by Eduardo Galeano. And so the issue here is the whole Americas was basically colonized by the Europeans. And so when you talk about even when you talk about Mexico or Bolivia, or you're really talking about, you know, Mexico is run by the European conquerors in some sense. So they are super racist against Native Americans, and they continue to be. But see, that's like me being a Mexican heritage does not equate to the Mexican government. The governments are part of this, the capitalistic system that oppresses people, basically, you know, exploits resources and stuff.
One thing I do want to say is the idea that so in the end, describing yourself as a white doesn't really mean anything. Is that what we're saying in the end? Because in the end, it's your heritage of where your family came from and struggled to get here. I think
it matters a lot. I think if you identify not as, because I know you're always talking about your Italian heritage,
and yep,
that's different than saying I'm white and I'm proud, because what is white mean?
You know? Right. So you're basically saying that when you go to the white, you're literally what the assumption is when you say that I'm proud of my whiteness is as opposed to my blackness. Is that what you're really? I'm trying to nutshell this a little bit.
Like why?
Again, I never refer to myself as white. I know
that's what I mean.
Not my thing.
There's a reason we don't. This because that going back to what I was saying, that's the normalization of race in this country where the default is white.
The only people who ever ask me if I'm white is when I'm on some government committee and they want me to fill out the thing on whether or not I'm black, Hispanic, Aleutian, Alaskan, and all that other stuff. That's the only time it ever really comes up.
Since school's about to start, let me propose an experiment for some people.
You have 21 seconds just to tell
you. If you walk into a classroom, a lecture hall, and there's all mostly white people in there, you probably won't feel abnormal. You probably won't even think about it. But if you were to walk into a classroom and it was all black people, you would say there's something going on here. Is this a cultural studies class? This is different than the normal, than the default. When you see all the CEOs and there's only one black CEO who then resigned from Trump thing, why is that normal? Why don't we notice race when it's all white?
David, as Monty Python once said, always look on the bright side of life, buddy. Thanks for your time today. Appreciate it. Ed, we'll see you tomorrow. Jim Manley, Goldwater Institute, second hour.
Intelligent Talk 24/7, AM 1030, KVOI, Cortero, Tucson. On the web at KVOI.com. The right side of life.